And this is also going to be a good gate for us to work out what skill level RPG is at, because we've only seen them play so far against SOA. So seeing them play against a Super Perfect team is going to be a really good level meter of seeing where exactly this team stands. But it looks like, unless they're baiting me again, no, we have the map pick here finally for the last one. And it is Battlefield, but it was an E-Star pick.
It was an E-Star pick for sure. That is quite interesting. Now, looks like E-Star also wants to play in this Battlefield, and I can't really blame them, because for the same reason that we wanted Hot Slater to play there, I think E-Star feels very confident there as well, because so far they have had nothing to worry about. They were stronger in teamfights, they were stronger in map rotations, so why shouldn't they be able to just make it a quickie on Battlefield of Eternity, just get that first Immortal, get the second one, and maybe by then the two keeps are already down.
Maybe. E-Star, we've seen them play on this map before in global competitions. Mm-hmm. That is something we should emphasize, and it has been scary. I believe this is the map that was the origination of Chinese Bush meta. It was this cursed where everyone was talking about that particular style back at one of the earlier BlizzCons. So we're going to have to keep an eye on it, see if Hot Slater are going to be able to deal with it, because E-Star, they're looking on fire, and when we were talking about the one map that Hot City have a chance on and E-Star actively picking against them, we know that there's going to be trouble.
Did you actually see that Tiger plays in a winter jacket there? For E-Star?
Yo, like a little puffer coat?
Yeah, look at that. He's actually playing in a winter jacket. Now, if I had to play in a winter jacket in a probably very warm studio, I would probably sweat so much that I couldn't press my buttons anymore. My fingers would literally slip from the keyboard.
I don't think it is warm. I think that is the point. They keep it cold so that the players can be as comfortable as they need to be. You can always put more clothes on. You can't really take them off at a production.
Man, that next level clothing meta from Thatcher here.
That's what I do. I never have my heating on because I can put clothes on. I can't. I guess I can take them off because I'm never on camera. But I would prefer to put clothes on and save electricity than take them off and also be uncomfortable.
That's the thing, right? You could literally wear nothing on those streams, regardless of IHGC China or Open Division Europe, because you're never really shown. So who knows what Tetra is doing behind the camera.
Don't encourage the chat. They're gonna take it too far. It's a bad idea. Oh, look, these bads again. None. we've managed to keep that going.
To be honest, though, I don't think there has ever been a series where the banning was so stale. I think the other teams always switched it around at least a little bit.
Yeah, this has been the exact same bans all three times in a row. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, that's not surprising, to be honest. However, the picks will at least be slightly different on this map. Less emphasis on global heroes, more emphasis on PvE damage.
By the way, if anyone is good at photoshopping images and faces, then please feel free to send me a David Hasselhoff Baywatch photo montage with Tetra's head on it, and I shall be using it next week on our overlays.
Dude, if you want to, seeing as I am an image, if you want to Photoshop, like I've saw someone suggest, just add dog ears to Tetra, just make it different each week. I do not have a huge issue. Keep it professional, obviously.
Yeah,
but
yeah,
I do not mind. I mean, you saw, did you see what Grubby was doing to me yesterday?
I saw the flappy head. Yes, I saw it. Canadian, it was very entertaining, Canada very texture. Cute. It reminded me of South Park, you know.
Very, very nice. Idea. Very funny. Someone is phoning me right now. What? No. From Birmingham? No, that's later. Not now.
Easter, okay, finishing off Hot Slater a little bit faster so Tetra can answer the phone call.
No, I've hung it up. I'll bring it back later. For now, Valor was the first pick coming in here for Hot Slater. Going to be able to get that lovely PvE damage with the Hungering Arrow build. Whereas E-Star, Malfurion, Muradin, the double Ms, very strong. Less PvE, unless you count Moonburn, which isn't still hugely effective. But it is still going to be good.
Yeah, indeed. Now, we see Battlefield of Eternity oftentimes come up with very exotic hero choices. First and foremost, I want to mention Artanis here. Amateur opponent is still a golden pick in my personal opinion, although it is oftentimes a little bit of a risky pick as well, because if you don't manage to get Immortals, he's pretty much a non-factor almost. He is very, very dependent on good swaps. If you don't get them in the first place, or if you overdo them, exposing yourself too much on Artanis, then you can basically be more of a liability compared to a boon. to your team. Now we see Tyrael again, this time for Hot's Lady, though. Interesting.
Alright, sanification on this map can be very effective if you allow you to dive onto the opponent's immortal a bit. Double Angel. It's been a while since we've seen this. I think it was Gold Club, actually, that we did see it last at the World Championships.
Yeah, in China for sure. Tyrael and Aurel, they provide a lot of protection. And I love the synergy between Vala and Aurel. We've seen that times and times again. In Europe, we even see double support comps with Lucio Aurel and Vala to really fully rely on your main ranged assassin player to always fill up that energy meter for Aurel and to really turn your team comp into this unstoppable force that enemies can't really kill, because there's so much shielding going on with Lucio's sound barrier, there's so much constant AoE healing going on from Aurel. I would actually like Hot's Lady to give that one a go. However, they would sacrifice a lot of damage if they did so.
Is that going to be worth it for them? Yeah, Tan is banned out by E-Star, removing that kind of PvE damage, and also would have been solid engage on the certification. Yeah. You were talking about issues Artanis could face. Tyrael deals with most of them, so banning it out, very solid by E-Star here.
Indeed. Now, wouldn't have been Artanis good for E-Star here. I think the blind could have actually kept Vala in check and denied a lot of damage potential for her, but I think they just want to be safe. Rather be safe than sorry here. They don't want to risk losing those bosses, those immortals, excuse me. I'm pretty sure we're going to see... I would actually go for a Greymane ban, because that's basically the big counterpart to a Vala. Vala goes for Hungering Arrows, deals a tremendous amount of damage to those immortals, and Greymane just counters that with strong Morgan form auto-attacks. But I think Li Ming is good too. Tiger just put on a clinic last game, and Li Ming, to be fair, is a very good pick here as well on Battlefield.
Yeah, Li Ming gonna be very strong here, gonna be, would have been aggressive pokes of banning it out, makes a lot of sense. A Nubarak coming in would have been a great counter to Li Ming, but now it's just little bit of backlight engage.
During all of those games, Tetcher, whenever an Nubarak was locked in China, it never really seemed to fit the composition. Like, it was run as a solo warrior on Braxis, got crushed. It was run against no mages, it was crushed. And in this game as well, it seems like a Nubarak is more... is not really able to unfold his full potential here, I feel.
A noob can block some of those Hungering Arrow shots from Vala.
True.
That is
with
a sacrifice. He positions himself, well, just it just itself. The Dampen Magic is going to allow him to block at least a little bit of that damage if they are on the defensive positioning. Greymane coming in as well, which does mean their comp is a little more dive friendly now. With a noob diving in, they at least have something to follow up on it.
Exactly. Now keep in mind, Anubarak might have also been picked for a different reason. Maybe they're going to go for Cocoon, and maybe they just want to deny Aurel from saving anyone once they go full ham on a target like Vala, for example. I would actually love to see a Cocoon against an Aurel comp.
As would I. It definitely seems like it would get a lot of value in terms of just preventing that healing and preventing the Aegis if you're able to time it well enough. The question is, what are Hot Lady going to go for that would be able to deal with this? You want preferably want some fast damage, some fast output. So Sonya, we mentioned it before, would be okay. She does actually offer a pretty decent amount of single target damage as well, but would also be able to offer the Whirlwind that is some good, very quick release damage to deal with that Cocoon.
And she can also go on a solo lane, which is something that Hot Lady is still lacking. I don't think Tyrael these days is a good enough solo laner anymore. And whoa, well, they go for fire and ice here.
Yeah, Ragnaros coming in, which can take the solo lane, and Arthas, who can also take the solo lane, but also offers a great response to Greymane, going to make it very rough for him to get the kind of damage output he wants.
Are we actually casting China Tetcher with Arthas and Anubarak being locked in the same match? Is that really true?
This is super weird. But we are casting China because it wasn't a new pick into no mages, really. But we can see if it works for them. I would like to see them pick another bit of dive or dive follow-up to try and capitalize on this.
Oh, I love that one.
That's good. A little bit of poke damage they now have. They have the sieging to follow up with the dive. Throw some spiders onto whoever gets engaged upon. That can work out for them.
And keep in mind, guys, although this is not typically a late-game map for Nezebo, his spiders, if he ends up going for the spider build, that is, still deal a tremendous amount of damage over time onto that Immortal, especially when you have that Spirit of Arcade talent at level 7, which always drops 5 spiders instead of 2 on a single target. And guess what? It's not really hard to point and click on that Immortal. So I really, really like the value that Nezebo brings on Battlefield, and it's oftentimes underrated and overlooked, I feel.
I would agree. Drop in those spiders, if you can get them stacked very early, even if you just drop them onto the Immortal, they just do an absurd amount of damage. We even see, used to see a while ago, people would still be a bit more friendly towards the Toad build, to just chuck Toads at the Immortal, because if the opponents are standing in front of it, they get hit by the Toads and take monumental amounts of damage. If they're standing behind it, then the Immortal gets burst. Mm-hmm. It is an interesting build that we haven't seen in a while, and I don't expect to see this time, because spiders are really good.
Yeah, they're really, really good. And keep in mind that there is always Gary the Gigantian, copyrighted, of course, by Calder. I think he was the one who invented the term. And Gary, or the Gigantian, whatever you want to call him, he's just such a formidable zoning tool as well, because keep in mind that there is a couple of unpassable terrain near those Immortals. So if you drop the Gargantuan in one of those little pathways, it's going to be so hard for the enemy team to really just walk through it, because he has that AoE slow, he has a strong single target basic damage. So I really, really love all the things that Nezebo brings to the table here on Battlefield of Eternity as well.
Yeah, I agree. It's going to be strong. We'll see if it does work out for them, Easter. I would say it's going to be interesting for E-Star. They can make anything work. This is really down to Hots Lady. They need to play very, very well. And sing, apparently. Sing yourself to victory, as we just saw in the little intro there. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to map number 3. Last chance for Hots Lady, but first, let's introduce E-Star. We have Greymane, we have Anubarak, Malfurion, Nezebo, and Muradin.
I just can't wait to finally have Heroes 2.0 and unlock my Nezebo announcer. That's literally going to be the first thing I ever do. Now,
the battle begins.
The battle begins. Hots Lady in red here. We see Auriel, Ragnarose, Arthas, Vala, and last but not least, Tyriel.
So, we're moving in straight away. Arthas, starting with the level 1 Root talent. Now, that is a little bit different. Not hugely uncommon.
Oh, Greymane!
Oh, no! Greymane, mistakes! The Zoff blocked him! Kill the wall! They're able to get him out! Zig-Z! Almost a horrible mistake. Muradin takes huge damage as they get out of there.
It was actually really lucky for Zig-Z here that the enemy team was not nearby. I think they may have actually anticipated that, you know, Hustley was more busy defending the bottom, but still, it's normally something you don't want to do too early.
We're seeing X taking a little bit of damage. By the way, Toads coming in from the Zebo at level 1.
Okay.
was that intended to be the Zebo quote there?
It was sort of both. It was my disbelief and Nezebo's battle cry when he goes for the Toads, for sure. I mean, that was just an interesting choice overall, I feel. Normally, okay, so in theory, there is this strategy behind, never mind, we see a death on Vala.
Bye, Vala.
Yep, bye-bye. But there is this theory behind Toads being really good against a heavy melee setup, because it's much easier to land a couple of Toads when the enemies are all clumped up, and it's not so easy to hit them when they're all spread out. So if they have a lot of backliners, you're probably not going to want to go Toads ever. But is it really good against the AoE shield from Tyriel? Is it really good against the AoE healing from Auriel? I remain skeptical, to put it in a very polite way.
It is good at sieging, is what I have to say on it. It gives good AoE sieging and forces heroes to use that kind of healing, like you say, for Auriel. Forces her to use it very early, so that she's not, and hopefully, if you're in that position where you're in a sieging situation, they're not going to be getting a huge amount of energy.
That is very true, and the Toads can be a formidable siege and disengage tool as well, because if you constantly drop those huge Toads, especially after acquiring the Toads of Hugeness talent at level 7, you're definitely going to scare away a couple of fragile heroes. So especially Vala and Auriel, they're going to have to pay double attention on where they step, because every path is a dangerous one when there's poisonous frogs leaping towards you.
And another interesting talent to point out here. Hot Pursuit from Vala, not Monster Hunter.
Yeah,
I'm not sure about this.
And another interesting one as well, look at Nunurek going for the magic armor on the Beatles. Like,
oh, what is this?
China, what are you
welcome
do?
To China. It's going to be good. And we're seeing a little bit of damage onto Ariel there, who immediately responds with the ribbon. But yeah, we're seeing, like I say, the magic on the Beatles still goes into our Burrow talent at level 4, so not too different here. Yeah. And Nzeebo is that big voodoo? No, that's Blood of Ritual, so yeah, he's going to be able to push more aggressively. Rag dropping that Molten Core to assist with the defense here as Tiger begins to move in, dropping as much damage as he can. Toad's dropped in, hitting that AoE damage, only really catching Valor with it though.
Yes, indeed, and we see Anubrek not really joining the rest of Istar. He's still holding his own against his Northrend counterpart, Arthas. They definitely want to make sure to continue soaking on that top lane as well. Tiger in trouble now, gets locked down and gets annihilated by Hod's Lady here. Nice synergy between Turiel and Vala.
Tiger making much like a lot of actual Tigers and becoming slightly endangered once again. X, once again, leaping to freedom, able to keep himself safe after taking a bit more of a longer escape route.
So I want to try to find reason and logic behind that Beetle build from a Nurbreg. Maybe he's considering the fact that he's playing against someone like Ragnaros, and if those Beetles have the magic armor, the 50 magic armor actually, nothing to be underestimated, one of the Q, or one of those Qs from Oz is not going to be enough to even just one-shot those Beetles, and they will remain for a longer period of time. That's literally the only thing I can think of.
He is against a lot of AoE ability power, actually. He has Ragnaros, Arthas AoE, Valor multi-shot. Lot of AoE, so it's not terrible here. If he wants those Beetles to help him solo lane, Burrow used here, Muradin in position to help him escape root lands, giving Arthas a stack, but not going to get him anything else.
Alright, so Tiger, he is not going to benefit from landing the spiders onto enemy heroes. He wants to hit them with Toads instead, and here we see the Toads of Hugeness coming in. Now the only thing that's still missing for him is, of course, fulfilling that quest challenge, so he's going to spawn 5 Toads instead of just 3.
Yes, because when you have Toads, there is only one thing that makes them better, bigger Toads, and then you make that better with more Toads. Now we're seeing Arthas getting knocked up by H here, but H turned on, but is able to pull back, getting healed by Malfurion, able to escape, and once again, X dwarf tossing to freedom.
I'm starting to get a little bit worried about Istar the more I take a look at their team comp. They don't have anything to keep Vala in check. They have no blinds, they have no attack speed slow except for Muradin. So as long as they don't shut down KTY, I think they're actually going to be in trouble, because this combo from Aurel and Vala is just going to be able to do so much for Hot's Lady. And they're already doing a lot better than in the previous games. They're keeping up in XP, they're actually pushing Istar back from their own Immortal here, which is pretty huge, and Istar for the first time in this series on the retreat.
Yeah, and Istar finally going to start work on Hot Lady's Immortal here, but this time for the first time, like I said, Hot Lady have a head start, and they are able to get to the halftime show first for the first time here, and the fact is they're still on even talent, so Hot Lady in a decent position for the first time here.
I think Istar, they basically realized that there's no way for them to really outrace this, so they're taking a lot more defensive positions right now. Istar X on that Muradin, he's trying to scout ahead a little bit. You can also see a heavy emphasis, on those side lanes here as well, because both teams want to rush to that level 10 as quickly as humanly possible. Look at Nzeebo in the top lane. We caught a glimpse here, doing great work against those top towers as well. With those Toads, of course, you can siege up like there was no tomorrow.
Noob, by the way, with the leeching scarabs, are getting even more sustained here. With those Beetles staying alive for even longer, he's going to get a bit more sustained out of it. X wading through all the damage to get into that back line, but is forced to dwarf toss out again. H narrowly dodging the Arthas route here. Arthas, he's attempting to get the stack, but he's having a little bit of trouble with it.
Yeah.
But once again, Istar being forced to retreat as Hot's Lady move on to the Immortal, and they will take their first Immortal of the game.
This is looking rough for Istar. You can basically see that they were nowhere near threatening anyone from Hot's Lady. The health bars were always up to 80-90% here, and no one ever was in the threat of dying as well. Aurel doing so much work here, 365, playing the game of his life here, it feels like. And also KTY on that Vala, showing that Xingxi is not the only mechanical player here in China, showing that there is more. And is Hot's Lady, I think if this is their big chance to make a move, they have to use it, because they're not going to get another one against Istar.
Yeah, and it's looking good for them so far. Immortals just about to run out of shield after breaking through the gates. They still have full health pool to get through to work down this fort. And looks like they're going to get it, even with the zombie wall down. Arthas just wiping that out. And the fort, we're going to take it to Zeebo, fully stacked on level the toads, 10. Though. Look at that damage onto the Immortal. Getting chugged down. It is dead. And the push will be sort of quelled here by Immortal. His health bar has disappeared off the portrait there due to the poison.
I'm so hyped about Tiger right now, because this is basically where he gets rolling on that Nazebo. I haven't seen a Toad build Nazebo in competitive in ages, so I have no idea how good it's going to be, Tetra, and we're going to be the very first two casters who can,
can finally say... Tiger, you beauty!
What is going on?
This is absolutely a siege build. I was talking about how the toads are used in this kind of siege style very rarely, which is why we were doubting it to begin with. And Ravenous Spirit, for the exact same reason, let's count the interrupts. One, two, done. We have the two heroics as interrupts. The Sulfurous dropped there on the Zeebo, so that's one less interrupt. It's Reign of Vengeance, basically, or nothing. Otherwise, they do have to use Sulfurous to stop the Zeebo stacking. Look at his positioning. Positioned over the wall in case there is a defense in this top lane.
This is
so we can
grab
us from over here.
Yeah, this is so cool. And keep in mind that Sulfurous Smash's cooldown has been nerfed greatly. It is now 80 seconds. And before that, it was only 60 seconds, so it's not a guaranteed factor that he's going to have it ready every single time Nazebo is going to use that Ravenous. Now, look at those toads, they're everywhere! You can't dodge them! Look at KTY taking
able to outrun
so
them,
much
KTY,
damage!
KTY getting chugged here, and so far, this is working very well, and the fact is, he's going to become tanky as well a bit later on, and he could, in theory, go for those Guardian Toads if he wanted to. The other damage output is from Valor, who has just gone for a standard multi-shot, so Superstition would work against her as well, but you want to be careful against Arthas with that, so it might be a bit unsafe. So the options for him here are Guardian Toads or Ice Block. Both would be decent here.
Absolutely. And something else to keep in mind. The more I look at those toads, the more I think Aurel is going to be in trouble, because she suffers. She struggles against poke damage from someone like Gul'dan or, in that case, the replacement Nazebo. Because if her team members are being forced back, if they're not able to fight back, then she's not going to regenerate any energy. So the more poke damage her teammates take, the more they're falling back.
Oh my god, from behind! Yeah. Zombie wall onto Aurel. Ravenous Spirit a little bit late there, but he's getting the damage output. The sanctification is dropped, but the damage output onto Valor, pretty decent here. Tiger just not taking any damage himself there, but he's able to drop KTY.
Arthas isolated.
Super low, and they're able to just completely split the team here. Lias here, completely out of position. The toads will zone out everyone from helping him, and he goes down.
That was so well done. Tiger confused the enemy team, it seemed like. He was just spreading so much damage and havoc as well in the backlines that Hotslave did not know how to position themselves. You really saw that Arthas was going in. He was like, yeah, I got this, boys. Are you here? Are you going to back me up anymore? Nope, you're all running back from that Ravenous Spirit. Okay, I guess I'm going to die.
Yeah, Nazebo, the fact is, if he's able to, if he's MVP at the end of the game, I'm very interested to see what his hero damage is, because they show that on the MVP screen, so we'll keep an eye out for that. Immortal halftime show, grabbed by E-Star here, able to put themselves in a strong position to try and grab a very high shield Immortal, but Hoss Lady not giving it up yet, they're moving into the defensive position, as Nazebo throws frogs at them.
he just... drops some casual random toads, and it still hits someone because of those huge toads just providing and covering so much ground. Look at Zingxi going deep into the backline, though.
Zingxi rushing down Aurel. The Aegis having to be dropped, and that does force Greymane to escape here. Twilight Dreams dropped, though, and that will guarantee the kill on at least someone. Down goes Tyrael. Ravenous is dropped. Aurel, flee, Aurel! She gets taken out. Down goes Rag, and it is just Arthas. That route, though, was very nice. Arthas will live. The Immortal will not, and it will be E-Star once again going to be able to push that top lane.
That was impressive. Once again, by E-Star. They just seem to make their team come work like a charm. They go for a very weird build on Nazebo, at least in competitive. They just seem to be all over the place, though, because Nazebo provides so much zoning, so much AoE damage at the same time. And guess what? It keeps getting worse if Nazebo is backed up by an Immortal, and he's just going to drop those toads from a safer location. And those Ravenous Spirits as well, over walls, it is so hard for Hotslade to determine where exactly it came from. And it's basically putting up a a ticking time bomb there as well, because either they find Nazebo in time and interrupt him, or they're most likely going to have to run away and lose the teamfight.
Yeah, they have one viable interrupt for that Nazebo, and that is Reign of Vengeance, and that forces Valor to get so close against a Greymane, against an Anubarak. It's almost impossible to get value. Good Aegis, stunned from the Molten Swing there. The Immortal, though, zoning out on a lot of heroes. Muradin is getting chunked down here. Nazebo getting chased by Arthas, just ruining him here. Zulfurus doesn't land on anyone. Damage is dropped, and Tiger finally drops it. 2-0, they want more. Now Furia getting chased by Arthas. We have a bit of a root fight there, and X is getting burned down, but it's taking so long because, well, he's Muradin.
Yeah.
Nice knockout by H. Will delay the chase.
He lives.
But X does live. He's able to get out. Tyrael's not done yet. He wants it. Good stun. And they're finally able to get out.
Yeah, that was beautifully played by X here for sure on that Muradin. It was also a dream scenario for him, of course. In a narrow choke point, you hit 4 or 5 enemy heroes with that Thunder Zone as well. So that means with healing static, you get twice the healing done. And that was basically the reason why Hotslade was not able to kill the dwarf. I would actually call that tactical feeding almost. An expression that I really want to get established at some point. But it's not like E-Star planned on dying here, though, and they should have played that a little bit more carefully for sure. But it's also not like Hotslade can capitalize on this victory. It's not like they can rush and counter keep immediately. And they did end up losing that top keep, which is the most important thing for E-Star. They inflicted permanent lane damage, and that's exactly what they wanted to do.
Yeah, and they had even more siege damage due to Nazebo's level 16 talent, the Poison Circle?
Ring of Poison, I think it's called,
Yes, which basically means Zombie Wall now just is a Ring of Poison. It just does damage over time to everything in the center.
Unfortunately, no toe talents at 16.
There is no toe talent at 16. The other options here would have been yet another spider talent, the spider colony, or soul harvest, which I wouldn't have felt so bad about.
Yeah.
That might have actually saved him against Arthas if he'd been able to get that extra ability power.
It's actually
extra health.
Yeah, soul harvest is actually the talent that Horsepants in one of his Nazebo guides recommended for the Toad build as well. It was posted on Reddit a couple of months ago. And keep in mind that you can basically drain energy from enemy minions as well, so as long as you're near a minion wave, you can get an infinite, or not really infinite, but a significantly large amount of bonus ability power, and combine that with 5 Toads and the Ravenous Spirit, it's going to bring a lot of pain to the enemy team. So yeah, that would have certainly been a viable alternative choice here as well.
And on activate, 25% health and ability power increase if, as long as you are standing in a minion wave or in all the enemy team. It is enemies, not heroes, like Kendrick perfectly said. It's a scary ability, but in this case, is going for the poison. Wants that even more siege damage. Drop that Ring of Poison on the Immortal.
You
see that cloud in the center there.
Look at that damage on KTY. One Toad brought down 25% of his HP. That is insane.
It is very scary. Arthas getting poked down once again by both the tanks. Zixi with the cocktails. It is just so much poke coming in here. Nazebo is working on the Immortal by himself here. You can see that health ticking down from the poison.
Now X being chased and focused down here by Hotslade. He took additional damage from that Howling Blast after acquiring the level 13 talent. Arthas can very well do that. And that beautiful engage here as well by Sulfur Smash was actually enough to take down Muradin, but can E-Star still hold here? They're fighting in a choke point, so Toads are getting a lot of value now. Nazebo dropping that Ravenous. He's taking the Aurel!
Bye-bye, Aurel. It turns around, begins to do some damage, but Arthas is going to destroy Nazebo. The Zombie Ball is dropped, though, and look at the damage onto Arthas. His health ticks down so much, but Zigzi now in full retreat. He's unfortunately heading towards the opponent's base. He needs to escape. He's trying to dodge the potential Meteor, gets the jump. He's trying to flee, dodges the Meteor, but the AoE damage from the Sulfurus gets the kill. And it is going to be Hotslade that wins the fight in a 5-3 trade there.
So I think Nazebo was basically aware of the fact that he would end up dying if he popped the Ravenous Spirit there, but at least he took someone else down with him. he basically went full kamikaze there for sure, because Arthas was so close to him, he was basically rooting him and slowing him with the Frozen Tempest. Yeah. But at some point, when you play Nazebo, you just have to be like, you don't care. And X, though, I think was the one with the initial misplay, though. Despite him being exceptionally tanky with that Muradin, you're not supposed to overstay your welcome like he did.
Yeah, and we definitely need to give a big shout out to Lias here. He is a big reason that Hotslade are still in this. He is Shunning all other responsibilities for Nazeebo duty, they know they can't win if Nazeebo continues to just keep control of the game.
Yeah.
So they just say, Arthas, you're not a Nubarak, but you're pretty damn close. Get in there and hit him until he stops. And that's exactly what he is doing.
Exactly. Now, Anubarak in trouble here. H took a lot of damage from the fall, from the Vala auto attacks here, who went for a standard W build, by the way, and did not go for Hungering Arrow once again. Now, yeah. Ilias once again in the backline here, gets repelled for now, though. X also trying to flank with that Murden. H, though, is deep in enemy territory.
Run H. The beetle gives him away a bit there. You can deactivate that to prevent it from happening. We're seeing lots of damage onto Refurian. The zombie wall's good, though. The poison will stick around, even though the zombies are dead. Aegis is dropped. Valor taking a lot of damage. Sanctification will keep her alive, at least for the moment. Ravenous Spirit doing huge damage into the AoE here.
One, two!
Raymate turns it around. They get Valor. Sulfurous, though, dropping a lot of health as well. But it's three heroes down straight away. Zig's able to vault for freedom. And Nazeebo moves in to try and get his revenge onto Arthas. X jumping through as well. They get the kill.
Yes.
And it is just Tyrael remaining. He will drop as well. And it is E-Star getting the full five-man team wipe for nothing in exchange. They're going to jump the wall. At least two of them will. The others have to take the long way around. And they are going to take the game and the series in a 3-0.
I love how Nazeebo also put a couple of guardian zombies around Malfurion there as well to keep him safe from any sort of counter engage here. Yeah, I think it was not on purpose, but he was trapping his own teammates in the zombie. Well, it didn't matter because Tiger, to me personally, was the MVP of game number 3 between E-Star and Hotslady, playing a wonderful Nazeebo, a wonderfully different Nazeebo here at that, making those totes look easy peasy. Hopefully we're not going to have too many Toad Nazeebos in Hero League right now who think they can do the same thing.
So let's talk about some of the picks here that we doubted at the start and some of the talent picks. For starters, the Valor multi-shot build, very much due to the fact that Ahriel needed energy. That is the first setup we need to build on that. Unfortunately, didn't work. They decided to forego Immortal Race in exchange for trying to keep up in terms of healing. The Anubarak pick, picked to prevent Nazeebo being countered. A sneaky little pick by
them.
Even though they picked it into something that it didn't counter, they were leading themselves in by picking away the main counter for their own hero. Very nicely done by E-Star.
Very nicely done indeed. And it's just so cool to see a refreshing approach, a refreshingly new approach to a hero that is, you know, normally always played in the same way, namely with that spider build, of course. So E-Star definitely earned a soft spot in my heart after making one of my most favorite heroes look so cool, even if they didn't go for the go-to build. Kudos, though, to Hotslady. I think out of all of those games, the third game was their best one, and it was maybe just too late for them to really find their rhythm. I think maybe E-Star also didn't really play 100% seriously in that last game. But anyway, I think Hotslady is here to stay. I think they're definitely a team to be reckoned with. And I'm looking forward to their future when they play against quote-unquote weaker teams.